Hello students, in today's video we will study some new topics of lesson 11, the revolutionary movement, formation of political parties, the Simon Commission, the demand for Purna Swaraj, the civil disobedience movement, the Dandi March, the Government of India Act 1935 and the Second World War. In the previous video, we had studied that Gandhiji had called off the non-cooperation movement because of the incident which occurred at Chauri Chaura in Uttar Pradesh. In this incident, 22 policemen were killed, and due to this, Gandhiji had called off the movement. So the non-cooperation movement was not successful. Mahatma Gandhi's desire of attaining Swaraj within 1 year of the movement was not fulfilled. The Khilafat issue was also left unsolved, but the mass participation in the movement rekindled the nationalist spirit and inspired people to face new challenges of the freedom movement. And the first topic, the revolutionary movement. Many young nationalist leaders were disappointed with the leadership of Gandhiji. They believed in using violence for the attainment of nationalist goals. They took inspiration from the revolutionary movements of Russia, China, Turkey, Egypt, etc. Punjab, Delhi, Bengal, and the United Provinces were the active centers of revolutionary terrorism. In North India, the Hindustan Republican Association, or the HRA, was formed in 1924 at Kanpur. It was formed by Ram Prasad Bismil, Jogesh Chandra Chatterjee and Sachindranath Sanyal. And the objectives of Hindustan Republican Association were the establishment of a Federal Republic of United States of India, to conduct political crimes and dacoits, to raise money and arms for the movement, have various departments of Hindustan Republican Association all over India. So in 1925, the Hindustan Republican Association conducted the Kakori conspiracy. A group of activists committed a dacoity in a train at Kakori and looted cash. Ram Prasad Bismil, Roshan Lal, Ashfaqullah Khan and Rajendra Lahiri, four of the 29 persons were hanged. The suppression of the revolutionaries led to the weakening of the Hindustan Republican Association. You can see the pictures of the Kakori martyrs. And the revolutionary nationalists such as Bhagat Singh and his comrades, they wanted to fight colonial rule and the rich exploiting classes through a revolution of workers and peasants. So for this purpose, they founded the Hindustan Socialist Republican Association, or the HSRA, in 1928 at Firoz Shah Kotla in Delhi. And Bhagat Singh and Chandrasekhar Azad were the main leaders. So HSRA aimed at establishing a socialist republican state in India. Members of the HSRA assassinated Saunders, a police officer, in 1928. This was done to avenge the fatal lathi charge on Lala Lajpat Rai during the anti-Simon Commission demonstrations, due to which Lala Lajpat Rai had died. And then on 8th April 1929, Bhagat Singh and Batukeshwar Dutt threw two bombs in the Central Legislative Assembly. Both were arrested and tried in the Central Assembly bomb case. This arrest was followed by more arrests of the HSRA leaders, and all were sentenced to jail. In jail, the activists launched a hunger strike in which Jatin Das, revolutionary, died on 12 September 1929. Bhagat Singh, Rajguru and Sukhdev were hanged on 23rd March 1931. Chandrasekhar Azad too died in an encounter with the police at Allahabad. And with the death of these activists, the HSRA movement in North India weakened. The next topic is the formation of political parties. Various parties were formed during this period. Some important among them were the All India Trade Union Congress was formed on 31st October 1920 with Lala Lajpat Rai as its president. The Bihar Socialist Party was formed in 1931 by J.P. Narayan or Jayaprakash Narayan and Phulan Prasad Verma in 1931. The Congress Socialist Party was formed in 1934. The party was greatly influenced by the socialist ideas of Jawaharlal Nehru. And the All India Kisan Sabha was formed in 1936. Which worked for the betterment of peasants and farmers. It won the support of the peasant class for the national movement. Then the Forward Bloc was formed by Subhash Chandra Bose in 1939. And in 1920, M.N. Roy founded the Communist Party of India at Tashkent. Soon many communist parties were formed in different parts of the country. And the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh or the RSS was also formed during this time. It was a Hindu organization. These parties have held very different ideas about the kind of country India should be. And the next topic is the Simon Commission. In November 1927, the British government appointed the Simon Commission under the chairmanship of Sir John Simon. The commission was to inquire into the working of the Government of India Act of 1919 and suggest new reforms. The Indians were dissatisfied with this commission. Firstly, because it had no Indian member. All the seven members were British. Secondly, the commission did not approve to the Indian demand for Swaraj. Consequently, the Indian National Congress decided to boycott the commission. A complete hartal was observed in Bombay and other places on 3rd February 1928, the day the commission landed at Bombay. People all over the country raised the slogan Simon Go Back and held demonstrations. The police had to resort to lathi charge. At Lahore, Lala Lajpat Rai was severely wounded during the lathi charge and he died later on. So you can see the pictures of demonstrations against the Simon Commission. People holding black flags and on it was written, Simon, go back. So you can see demonstrations by people in various parts of the country, especially at Bombay. You can see even women are demonstrating. Then the next topic is the demand for Purna Swaraj. In December 1929, the Indian National Congress held its session at Lahore with Jawaharlal Nehru as the president. The main features of the session were Congress passed a resolution demanding Purna Swaraj, that is complete independence for India, boycott of central and provincial legislatures, boycott of all future elections, launch of the civil disobedience movement. These were the main features of the Lahore session of Congress in 1929. On 31st December 1929 at midnight, Jawaharlal Nehru hoisted the Indian tricolour flag on the banks of river Ravi in Lahore. The Congress Working Committee declared 26 January 1930 to be the Purna Swarajya Divas or Complete Independence Day. And for the next 17 years, it was celebrated as the Independence Day. However, since India finally got independent on August 15, 1947, the constitution was enforced on this day and is hence celebrated as Republic Day. And then the civil disobedience movement of 1930. So let us understand the meaning of civil disobedience. It is a refusal to obey a law on the grounds that it is immoral or unjust in itself. It appeals to the majority's sense of justice in order to get them to reconsider and change public policy. So the main goals should be to put the issue on public's agenda, to call attention to an unjust law. Disobedience must be open and public. So a civil disobedience movement was started by Mahatma Gandhi in 1930. The Congress launched the civil disobedience movement in 1930 under the leadership of Gandhiji. The main objectives of the movement were violation of salt law, non-payment of land revenue and other taxes, boycott of foreign clothes, boycott of government-controlled institutions, offices and schools, picketing of liquor shops, organizing strikes, meetings and demonstrations. These were the main objectives of the civil disobedience movement. Gandhiji started the movement by the violation of the salt law on the sea coast at Dandi. So the salt law required people to pay tax on the purchase of salt. The famous Dandi March by Mahatma Gandhi. The British government had a monopoly over the manufacture and sale of salt. Mahatma Gandhi and other nationalists felt that it was sinful to tax salt since it was an essential item of our food. Gandhiji launched the Salt Satyagraha movement on 12th March 1930. As salt was consumed both by rich and the poor, it was the poor who was mainly burdened by the imposition of salt tax. Gandhiji marched from Sabarmati Ashram in Ahmedabad to the coastal town of Dandi. He marched over 240 kilometers. Here he broke the government law by gathering natural salt found on the seashore and boiling sea water to produce salt. The movement soon spread to different parts of the country. Here you can see Mahatma Gandhi breaking the salt law by gathering natural salt found on the seashore. He is accompanied by many followers. The movement soon spread to different parts of the country. People began to violate salt laws and produce salt. In Tamil Nadu, C. Rajagopalachari also led a march from Trichinopoly to Vedaranyam and violated the salt law by picking up salt. You can see the picture. And peasants, tribals, women, they all participated in large numbers. And you can see the picture of Sarojini Naidu. She also was very active in the national movement since the early 1920s. Naidu was a significant leader of the Dandi March. She was the first Indian woman to become president of the Indian National Congress in 1925. You can see her marching along with Mahatma Gandhi during the Dandi March. And this is the picture of Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan. He was a Pashtun leader from the Northwest Frontier Province, also known as the Badshah Khan. He was the founder of the Khudai Khidmatgars, a powerful and non-violent movement among the Pathans of his province. So Badshah Khan was strongly opposed to the partition of India. He criticized his Congress colleagues for agreeing to the 1947 division of India into India and Pakistan. And the next topic is the Government of India Act 1935. The main features of the act were: the act granted provincial autonomy. Every province was given a council of ministers, and the governors now had to act on the advice of their ministers. The act made provisions for the establishment of a federal court. The act gave special powers and responsibilities to the governors. There was establishment of a federation of India if more than 50% of princely states decide to join it. Federation meaning it is a union of a number of self-governing states or regions which are joined together under a central government. But it never happened because the princely states, they did not agree to join and form a federation. Then the union executive consisted of the governor general and a council of ministers. The ministers were the members of the legislature and appointed by the governor general. And here, provincial autonomy, it is such a system in which the government of the provinces is independent from any external influence and does not rely on any of the external forces, meaning they can act independently. The act divided the powers between the center and units in terms of three lists: the federal list for the center with 59 items, provincial list for provinces with 54 items, and the concurrent list for both with 36 items, and the rest were the residuary powers which were given to the Viceroy. Even now we have the central list, the state list, the concurrent list, and the concurrent list means they include subjects which are of common interest to both union and state government. Both center and state government can make laws. In case of conflict, laws by central government prevails. So, items like education, forest, marriage, trade unions, adoption, succession, they all fall under the concurrent list. And the residuary powers, they do not come either under the union, state or the concurrent list. Those items are in the residuary list. And it was exercised by the Viceroy. And like I told you before, the federation never came into being as the princely states did not join it. The government announced elections to the provincial legislatures in 1937. The Congress formed governments in 7 out of 11 provinces. The Congress ministries did notable work in the social field, like upliftment of village industries, promotion of education, welfare of tribals, release of prisoners, and upliftment of Harijans. However, the Congress ministries resigned when Britain dragged India into the Second World War in 1939. 39. The Second World War. The Second World War broke out in September 1939. The Viceroy declared India to be an ally of Britain without even consulting the Indians. The Congress was against the use of Indian resources in the war. The Congress opposed the aggressive policies of Germany and Italy, but it clearly stated that India could not fight for democracy of other nations when she herself was not free from foreign rule. So the Congress agreed to support the British only if they declared India to be an independent nation after the war. It also demanded the setting up of a representative government at the center during the war. The British government, however, did not respond to the demands of the Congress, and so consequently the Congress ministries resigned in November 1939 to show their protest. And in the annual session of the Congress held at Ramgarh in March 1940, the Congress offered to cooperate with the British government if it set up a provisional government at the centre. So, this is the end of today's video. And in the next part, we'll study about the Cripps Mission, Quit India Movement, and the other topics given in your book. So by the time, please read the chapter. I've been telling you time and again, read the chapter thoroughly. Thank you, children.